Cave Elizabeth Planning Board. First order of business is the minutes of the previous meeting dated March the 18th, 1997. Does anybody have any comments, additions, corrections, suggestions?
Madam Chairman?
Yes, Mr. Azulino.
Couple of comments. In the minutes, Dominicus Crossing subdivision, paragraph 3.
On the first page?
On the very first page, thank you. Third paragraph, sixth line, starts with the sentence, "Within the open space, they are developing all but 1.2 acres of land as undeveloped open space." I withdraw that. I see there was a, I didn't understand the wording, and there was a period there, and I missed it. Apologize.
Okay, no problem.
On page 3, second full paragraph.
Mm-hmm.
Second line, a detention basis. Is that intended to be basin?
Basin, yes, S to N. Thank you.
Fourth paragraph, same page, last line.
Trees.
Trees, I assume, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Page 4, last line of the second paragraph. He sees this as apparent density compared with overall density. Is that wording? I don't understand what it says. Maybe it's right, but I don't.
I believe that was, to my best of my recollection, what the sentence said, but I'm perfectly happy to have other people comment on it. Would you like some edification about what apparent density is?
No, if the wording is correct, then I accept it as it is.
Okay.
That'd be fine. On page 5, third paragraph from the bottom of the page, third line from the bottom of that paragraph, the sentence begins, "With regard to the pole, Fitzpatrick Associates," the sentence reads, "has made." I believe Mr. Fitzpatrick said he will make contact, but had not yet done so. That was my recollection.
Which paragraph?
This is the third.
Third paragraph from the bottom of the page.
Has made contact.
And the third, the second to the last line of that paragraph. I don't think, maybe somebody else has a better memory, but having this is being an issue I raised, I thought he said that he would make contact.
No, you're correct. That's what he said.
Well, I actually believe he said he had already contacted the CMP once and that he would, as a result of this meeting, go back and ask them specifically what could be done.
I will defer to your recollection if that's what it was. Mine was that he said he would make...
But I think you raise a good point, which is, regardless of what he had done in the past, he did say that he would make contact the CMB,
yes,
to see what could be done. So why don't we change "has made" to "would make," and then that would, that certainly, I believe, is within the, do you agree with that, Mr. Parkhurst, that he agreed to take on that responsibility?
Yes.
Anything else, Mr. Azulino?
That's it. Thank you.
May I say it's a distinct pleasure to have somebody who carefully reads minutes.
Good reason to keep new board members.
Everybody has a job, right?
Any other suggestions, additions, corrections, whatever, to the minutes? Okay. We've got then those two corrections, typos on page 3, and the insertion of two words on page 5. Do I hear a motion to have the minutes as approved as corrected?
So moved.
Mr. Parker, thank you. Mr. Azulino, you
second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Raise your right hand. Thank you. Mr. Emery abstains. Since he wasn't here, he doesn't know what happened last week, or last month, I should say, except by virtue of reading the minutes. Okay. Correspondence received since the last meeting. A letter from the Public Works Director regarding the Fort Williams Ball Field, memorandum from the Code Enforcement Administrator regarding a wetlands boundary, letter from the Town Attorney regarding the Cunner Lane lawsuit, training workshop announcement, letter from the Town Attorney regarding the Dominicus Crossing letter of credit, letter from the Town Attorney regarding the Dominicus Crossing conservation easement, letter from Jay Harris regarding Beacon Lane public access waiver, letter from the Code Enforcement Officer regarding the Lawton public access waiver, and zoning news for March of 1997. Believe the next order of business is the Dominicus Crossing thank you very much. I've been reminded that there are also other correspondence that is on the podium this evening and that I should read into the minutes. There is a memorandum from the Conservation Commission dated April the 14th, 1997, regarding various planning board agenda items. There is a letter from T.Y. Lynn dated April the 14th regarding the Dominicus Crossing cost estimate review. This is regarding the proposed letter of credit. There is a memorandum from the Code Enforcement Administrator dated April the 14th regarding ball field site plans at Lyons Field. A letter from Bob Malley, the Director of Public Works, regarding the shore walkway at Fort Williams Park. A letter from Richard Berman regarding the plumber request for interpretation of wetland boundaries in the Dyer Pond Road area. A letter from the Conservation Commission regarding the Monk's Japanese Pond Road wetlands alteration permit. And finally, a letter from Ram's Head Partners, LLC, regarding the wetlands alteration permit at Ram's Head. I'll ask the town planner whether the applicant before us, or the applicants before us this evening, have received copies of these most recent correspondence, and of course she says yes. Okay. Next order of business is, thank you, Dominicus Crossing subdivision, a request by Dominicus Crossing Limited Liability Company for final subdivision review, and a wetland alteration permit for Dominicus Crossing, a 97-lot plus one multifamily unit subdivision located on Wells Road and Sawyer Road under Section 16-2-4, major subdivision review, public hearing, and Section 19-3-9, wetland alteration permit. Mr. Dewan, do you want to summarize the changes that have occurred since the last meeting?
Glad to. Good evening. My name is Terry Dewan, landscape architect in Yarmouth, representing Dominicus Crossing, LLC. With me tonight is Amy Bell, landscape architect from my office, Peter Anassis from Anassis and Lonis, the home builder for Dominicus Crossing, and Juan Perez, one of the general partners in Dominicus Crossing. On March 28th of this year, we submitted a rather lengthy package to the board, which outlined all the changes that we made since the public hearing on March 18th. Along with this package, there was a number of other appended items, some additional drawings, and so forth. What I would like to do rather briefly is to outline the changes that we've made to the plan, not to spend a lot of time on the details, and then turn it back over to the chair. We have had a chance to review the planner's memo dated today. We've talked with her on a couple of occasions about the information contained within it, and we would like to discuss this with the board tonight and hopefully hear the gavel bang.
Sounds good, Mr. Dewan. Keep going.
Thank you. First of all, some of these areas I'll give more weight to than others because we have had quite a bit of discussion on things like tree planting. I will just say in passing on tree planting, we have taken the information we presented the last time, namely that people living in the development will have a chance to select from a number of different tree species. We've included a note to that effect on the landscape plan, and this note gives the type of trees that will be suitable for individual situations. Okay, going on to page 2, one thing which we have added is a low-planted berm on the back side of Juan Perez's house, is to add some measure of privacy. And of course, this works both ways, between his house and garage and barn and the new homes and vice versa. These are shown on two sheets that shows the berm. The berm's essentially going to be 2 feet higher than what's out there right now. Phase 1 housing prototypes plan was a sketch that we showed you the last time. I know that one or two of the members asked for more detail on that plan. We've given that to you. We've shown typical houses with dimensions, setbacks, garage locations, spacing between homes. And these were presented in plan form to show what the elevation that we showed last time would look like. And as we mentioned, those homes that we had shown were photographs of typical homes that may be suitable for phase 1 of Dominicus Crossing. These were photographs of homes taken in Village Brook as a cluster subdivision in Yarmouth. Central Maine Power Company transmission line crossing. CMP, of course, recognizes the fact that there is a trail on the transmission line right now, and if there is a road crossing, we have filed a permanent use agreement with the CMP. It's in their hands right now. We've had many correspondence and contacts with them. We don't anticipate any problem in getting that final agreement, and the terms of the agreement will be submitted to the town for review when they're completed. That's really the only thing we had to report on that issue. We added a general note on utility location relative to the transformers and utility services, namely that we'll be coordinating with the utility companies. Probably the most exciting thing that I have to report has to do with lighting fixtures. And if you recall last time, we had to hold up the what we call the generic colonial or the town and country fixture. And I know that most of us who see these typical, what I like to refer them as living room lights on a big pole fixtures, that is the traditional one that CMP uses if you don't like their cobra heads. Well, I guess in the spirit of deregulation of the power industry, they are realizing they have to be much more competitive with other utilities around the world. And so they have selected at least two fixtures right now, one through Hall of Fame and one through General Electric, which well, they'll be bringing to the public utility companies later on this month. The idea is that downtown redevelopment, subdivisions, and any place else that uses light fixtures within the public right-of-way will now have more fixtures to choose from. And so we included in our package a catalog cut from the Hall of Fame catalog. And if any of you are interested in seeing what it looks like in full color, we have it here, although the fixtures themselves are in black and white. I think they're going to be a lot more handsome addition to the streetscape than the rather flimsy ones that we thought we were going to be using in the past. So that's where we stand on that. I can't absolutely say what the policy is right now because it's still in the process of being developed by the PUC and Central Maine Power Company. We would like to have the flexibility, though, to take one of these fixtures working with the planner and to use that on the locations that are shown on the plans. And we have a note to that effect that's been added to the drawing. The conservation easement, we didn't make an appearance before the Conservation Commission, as you know, on March 25th. We do have a letter from the Conservation Commission, which is in your package. It was dated yesterday, April 14th. Essentially says that the Conservation Commission, the deed of the Conservation Commission to be held by the Land Trust has been reviewed. The Commission is very pleased to note that their suggestions were incorporated into this document, and that the Commission noted that the developer responsible for the construction of the trails in the open space, and that we'll be working with the Conservation Commission on the location of those trails. And the Conservation Commission has no further comment at this point on the wetland alteration permit. The open space issue is another thing that we made a major change subsequent to the last meeting. If you recall, last time we had talked about transferring the open space in phases to the town. The intent now is after Phase 1 and prior to the initiation of Phase 2, we'd be deeding the entire open space parcel of over 100 acres, 101.36, to the town. And we have included in that the common open space, the common green in Phase 1, the common green in Phase 2, half basketball area in Phase 2, and the trail system, as well as the space for the picnic area, which may be built by the town. And there are notes to that effect that have been added to the drawing. The town council meeting went well, I suppose, last night. We did manage to get approval from the town council, and I know Mr. McGovern is here tonight to clarify that situation. We appeared before them to discuss the revisions that were made to the conservation easement, and we did get our conditional municipal approval reinstated. Declaration of easements, restrictions, and covenants. There were some minor changes to the language there that was added relative to street numbering and architectural review. Easements to lots 47 and 48. That was the reciprocal agreement for the two lots that were adjacent to the drive into the Boy Scout property. That language has been submitted to the town, and that language will be included in the deeds for these lots. Phasing has changed also. You read the letter. It details exactly what's going to be built in each of the five phases. The major change, and we're showing it on the board right here, is that Phase 2, which is Lorenzo Lane, is now going to be either the fourth or the fifth phase to be developed. If you recall, before we were going to be building Phase 1 to that point, and then Phase 2, Phase 3, and Phase 4. We've decided to put Phase 2 into a later phase. The intent now is to start here off of Wells Road, come into that point for Phase 1. Phase 2 would be this segment right here. Phase 3 would bring it all the way over to Sawyer Road. We mentioned in the submittal that we would like to have the flexibility of either building Layton Road or Lorenzo Lane as either Phases 4 or 5. We're showing them as Phase 4 here and Phase 5, but that may change. All the other facilities that go along with it, the infrastructure, the open space, the trails, the development of the common green and so forth do not change. The position and the development of the affordable housing units, for example, those all remain the same relative to the individual phases. It's just that the order of the phasing has changed. Stormwater management, there is really no new information to add. I talked last time about how we're handling stormwater between lots 71 and 72 in response to our inability to get an easement from the Rod and Gun Club. We feel that's been a good solution, and we've gotten our final approval from the Corps of Engineers. We anticipated getting our final approval from DEP today. We've been told by Mary Beth Richardson that it's all set to be signed. Lot 22 really has not changed since the last time we discussed it relative to the building sites that are on the lot. Driveway locations, again, a response to a comment that Maureen had raised last time. There are four lots that have minor amounts of wetland crossings that are shown on the drawings, and if the driveways are constructing these locations, there will be no additional permitting required by the lot owners. Because of the change required by the new detention basin, we had to revise the total acreage. There's a little bit more common open space and slightly less area in house lots. So that revised acreage total puts it there for the record. Response to TWLN comments, we have made all the comments that were made by Steve Bradstreet. The H2M has taken care of all those. We really don't feel there's any further issues there relative to the engineering review. Performance guarantee, we have a draft irrevocable letter of credit from Peoples. This has been reviewed, as you can tell by your package. Steve Bradstreet, in a memo of yesterday, reviewed it. He felt that, he compared the numbers that we got, which were from one contractor, he compared it to the Department of Transportation's item unit price bid averages for projects that have been awarded over the last 3 years to the DOT, and he felt that we were somewhat on the low side. Just for the record, the number that he came up with is about 2.7% above what we had estimated. So we feel that we're certainly within the ballpark, and that the $40,000 that he feels that we're off by is certainly covered by the 10% contingency that we had added to the total for the entire construction project. For the record, we've also added construction cost estimates for the subsequent four phases. So those are the changes, those are the additions that have been made to the plan. And at this point, I guess I would like to turn it back over to the chair. We would like to talk then about the memo from Maureen.
Okay. Do board members have any particular questions at this point, or shall we proceed to address the memo from Maureen? Mr. Azulino.
The revision to the phasing, 1, 2, 3, et cetera, could you put a timeline on that? How long is phase one? How long is phase two? How long is phase three? Approximately.
I would like to think that phase one will probably be built in a year to a year and a half. Phase two, which will be a fairly short phase, will probably take less than a year. So I would say between the two of them, it's probably a two-year, two-and-a-half-year time frame.
And phase three is the phase that,
that goes
completes
all the
road
to Sawyer Road.
And, that's and that would be within what time frame?
I would say it's probably a year's time frame.
So we're talking about 3 years? Is that
yes.
Correct? Thank you.
And then what about for phase four and phase five, Mr. DeWine?
Phase four, again, to build the road is probably a year's project. It may take 2 years to build out all the houses that are in there. And the last one is probably, a year's time to build the road and to build most of the houses.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
Just a quick question on number of house lots in each phase. Do you have that right there, Terry? I'm sure it's in our package here somewhere. I'm sure it is, but. This is in your revised phase.
I should know this like my kids' own name.
So.
I forget them occasionally, too. We can find that in a minute.
Okay, fine.
Mr. Emery, did you have a question?
Yes, I was asking the town planner a question, but just help me if you answer the question. On Lorenzo Lane, is there a restriction as to where the construction traffic would come from? Would it be restricted to Sawyer Road at that point, or is it
not? Lorenzo Lane is this one right here. Construction traffic can come from either direction.
And within your architectural or design guidelines, just a couple of questions. One, there's a constant reference to the contractor, not the contractor, but just contractor. I don't understand. Is that Mr. Onassis's organization?
Onassis and Lonis.
Could those be revised so that it's legally clear that the contractor refers to the co-developer or Mr. Onassis's construction company? Because what I'm concerned with is that if lots are sold and other contractors get involved, which is not at all unusual, Stonegate being a prime example, then I don't think there's going to be much concern about some of those contractors adhering to some of these issues unless it specifically rests with either Mr. Onassis' organization, Onassis' organization, I'm sorry. the other question is, I think it would be extremely helpful if these design guidelines had, in the way that the town center guidelines have, some graphic representation of what it is that you're expecting of the contractor and the homeowner. For example, there's a suggestion that fencing would help in the public spaces or in landscape detailing, but there's no description of those fences, nor is there any specific restriction with respect to chain link fence in the front yard area. And in my experience, chain link fence knows no economic bounds. It typically only knows a bound of whether people own dogs or not. And once again, the unusual aspect of this application is that it's cluster zoning, so we're writing the rules as we're reviewing the application. And lastly, on the plant list, I was reviewing the cost for plants, and I guess I was a little surprised that they were only $200 a tree. But in reviewing the plant list, I see that the trees are, the street trees are typically 2-inch caliper. And that's the minimum required under the ordinance. And I guess the trouble with setting minimums with any ordinance is that that's all that anyone, people feel comfortable providing only the minimum. My suggestion would be that that's really not an appropriate or a large enough sized tree given the effect that you're trying to create with the neighborhoods. And it's an unusually small tree for development of this, let's call it economic type. In school projects, we typically don't specify trees less than 3 inches and typically 3.5 to 4 inches to be sure that they survive vandalism or damage. Particularly concerned because trees are measured higher than they used to be and you end up with a very small tree at a 2-inch caliper. So I would recommend that you discuss it with the tree warden, but I would really strongly prefer to see 2.5 to 3-inch caliper as a minimum tree size. And I applaud you for the variety of trees that you've shown on your list, but I would have some concerns that perhaps some of the gray birch or other birch, if they were to be street trees, might not have a long enough life, or as happens in some of the Cape neighborhoods now, particularly mine.
No gray birch in that list.
The branches sometimes, gray birch or whatever, but I assume that this has been reviewed by the tree warden and will receive his blessing before construction.
Yeah, these are trees that are selected from the town's
yes.
official list.
And
gray birch is not on the list, it's yellow birch.
Yes. I think that for now is my comments. Thank you.
Any other comments from board members before we proceed? Mr. DeWan, I note that Mr. McGovern is in the audience now. I don't know whether he is staying for the ball fields issue as well, or if he's only staying for this one. We'd be certainly happy to work in a presentation now and not make you wait any longer than you have to. What's your pleasure this evening?
I'm here for the evening.
Are you? Fair enough. Then I think we'll proceed in an order that makes sense.
I do have the response from Mr. Carlson's request.
Please.
Thank you.
Yes, for number of lots for phase one, we have 32 lots. Phase three, and now phase two, there are 8 lots for the center section. Phase three that goes over to Sawyer Road is 25 lots.
45?
25. Clayton Road is 20 lots. And Lorenzo Lane, which had been phase two, is 11 lots.
Then the phase one and two being a total of 40 lots, that's when the Sawyer Road would be put in, right, after 40 homes. Is that a good assumption?
That's correct. That's when the connection would be made, yes.
In other words, 40 homes off Wells Road, and then after that, you'll open up Sawyer Road for
that's
the
correct.
Remaining part of the project or wherever you need the traffic to go. Okay. Thank you.
Let's proceed to the town planner's memo, then, Mr.
Okay.
Well, we've already discussed, I believe, most everything on the discussion portion, under phasing, performance guarantees, lots 47 to 48 in access, picnic areas. As a condition of approval, we'll be more than willing to add the note, picnic area to be built at the option of the town.
Fair enough.
Portland Water District letter. They are in the process of reviewing the various designs for the pump station, the telemetry, and so forth. And we've been told that it's in the review process and that should be forthcoming. Okay, under covenants, perhaps I can ask Maureen to explain her concern. We've had a discussion over on the telephone here. As I understand it, our covenants allow only single-family residential use, while the ordinance allows accessory dwellings. And the recommendation is to expand the allowable uses within the subdivision that would also allow accessory dwelling units as a permitted use on the lots.
I'm not sure that your covenants prohibit accessory dwellings. What it states is that there shall be a single-family use, and I was concerned that that could be interpreted to exclude anything other than a single-family use, so that if someone wanted to have a home occupation, or they wanted to operate a small daycare, or they wanted to open up an accessory dwelling unit, things that are allowed in residential neighborhoods right now, that there could be an interpretation taken that it wouldn't be permitted in the this subdivision. But the board should keep in mind that the covenants are really a private agreement between the lot owners. And what this would do is allow an abutting lot owner to privately argue with someone. It would not have the effect of regulating our land use code and our zoning ordinance. I highlighted it because I thought it might create some confusion in case someone wanted to take one of those options and bring it to the town for, say, the zoning board for a conditional use approval, and have a neighbor get up and say, well, you can't allow it because it's not allowed by our covenants anyway. That's the reason I brought it up. The other item in that paragraph, starting paragraph 6, I identify item 17. That's actually item number 8. And if you look in the covenants, you'll find that it talks about allowing the alteration of water flows between lots. And this has been a problem in other subdivisions in the town, where there's been a subdivision plan approved by the planning board in some cases many years ago. In some cases, there has been a drainage area that's run along the back of lots. And as homeowners landscape and are proud of their homes, they tend to want to make the entire yard as attractive as possible, and sometimes drainage detention areas tend to be seen as less than attractive. One lot owner fills that area and they create a pond next door. So I don't see that as being as much of an issue in this subdivision, because the applicant has done an excellent job of pulling lot lines away from those detention areas. But again, just the fact that it says it in the covenant could create a problem down the road. What it says is you can do it as long as you check with all the affected lot owners. Well, I mean, my suspicion is that someone will talk to the neighbor next door, and they won't go all the way down through the entire drainage area. Again, it's probably much less of an issue for this subdivision than it would have been in some past subdivisions. And I did not suggest it as a condition at the end of the memo, but I did highlight it for the board to consider.
Also, most, if not all, the drainage easements, or all the drainage ways are within easements. So there is a measure of control that the town has over this issue.
Mr. DeWan, could we back up to the first section, first concern on the covenants? Was there an intent, or is there an intent on the part of the applicant to restrict home use and the kinds of things that are currently allowed now in
the
residential?
No.
Because if there is no intent to restrict, it might be a good idea to simply do something now to signal the fact that those are welcome activities, and then we'll...
Yes, that certainly is our intent, and to do that as a condition of approval to make that change.
For the benefit of Mr. Bryant, perhaps we could say, since he's just walked in, that what the intent was here in terms of the easements on the covenants is perhaps to allow, well, let's say it this way, that there is a restriction right now to the use of single-family homes, and that the concern is that that might be read at some later date to prohibit accessory dwelling units which are allowed in other neighborhoods. And if there is a willingness to allow that, that would be helpful. With respect to this second issue in terms of drainage, do we have comments from the board on that, or is there a particular reason why you have requested that here, Mr. Dewan? Is there a particular reason you've requested the drainage flexibility here?
We didn't think that really deserved any further consideration. This is an issue that the planner had brought up, and I think we're happy leaving it just the way it is. I think that was Maureen's recommendation also.
Okay. Before we go any further on the memo, I'd like to...
Madam Chair.
Sure. Excuse me. Yes, Mr.
With respect to drainage, for example, in Stonegate, there was a restriction on clearing within 15 feet of the property line, except for dead trees and issues with respect to drainage. It was not real difficult to go in and clear trees and reduce the buffer. I guess what I'd be concerned about is that the homeowner decides to reconfigure drainage. And homeowners can get very creative in terms of drainage, and Maureen's absolutely right. Our office has dealt with any number of issues where developers had not constructed the subdivision according to design, and water ends up puddling on the lots, or somebody gets there first and they raise their house and then the water sheets off onto the abutter's house. My main concern with that, I think that can all take care of itself in litigation, unfortunately, but that may be the only way to resolve it. But I wouldn't want the homeowners to have the discretion to alter a drainage easement or a perfectly good drainage way between flowing between two lots and at the same time remove the trees. So I'm not sure how that's addressed here, but whether or not the restriction on removing trees adjacent to the property line would take precedence over this affording two joint neighbors to reconfigure the lot drainage.
If the town has a drainage easement over it, they would have to discuss it with the town prior to any action on their part.
Excuse me, but typically there's, I can't remember what the buffer is on your lot, but typically there's about 15 feet on either side of the property line. And for whatever reason, particularly on smaller lots, for the desire to get additional daylight in or to press driveways very close to the side lot line to increase the usable area of the lot, it's not at all unusual that property owners will redirect water and they'll also cut down trees. And it's very easy to say that the only reason you're cutting down the trees is to make the drainage work, when in fact the true purpose of cutting down the tree is to expand the usable area of the lot above that which was at least understood to be approved by the planning board when the lot sizes were established under cluster zoning. And again, I'm not trying to be arbitrary or difficult. I'm just concerned that we have a cluster, we're under cluster provision here, and these lot sizes are fully arbitrarily determined in most part by the applicant and by the site. And without being very clear about any stipulations with respect to clearing or grading things after the fact, it's not clear to me that we're going to get, when we go to the site, we're not going to see the benefits of cluster development if people are arbitrarily regrading common lot lines and removing trees. So I think there needs to be something within the covenants that restricts the removal of trees as a matter of convenience under the guise of regrading for drainage.
Well, I guess I don't mean to be arbitrary either, but this seems to be an opening that you could sort of drive a fairly good-sized truck through if you wanted to. And I'm not sure. I guess my preference at this point would be simply just to delete item 8. And if there were a difficulty, it doesn't seem to be that much trouble to come back to the planning board to try to see if there is something. I mean, we've actually entertained some very minor movements of lines and whatnot among adjoining landowners now, and if you just have a chance to let somebody look at it, if it's fine, then there shouldn't be any trouble with it. But the question of all affected lot owners is beauty is in the eye of the beholder.
At this point, I don't see any problem in just deleting it. That's, that meets, that addresses the concerns that the board has.
Yes.
That would be fine. Anything else on covenants? Mr. Dewan, moving back up for a moment to number three in the town planner's memo, I understand that we've got the agreement in terms of that what's been done is the conveying of rights of access in the shared driveway. What, remind me or tell me what's happening with respect to the Boy Scout land.
Okay, lots 47 and 48. There is a common driveway over both of these lots, which also provides access to the Boy Scout land adjacent. And but this is a cross-access easement, so you know, one passes over the other. It also provides access for the Boy Scouts to use their land on the back side.
Has that access to the Boy Scouts also been noted on the deed? On the proposed easement?
There is a signed easement between the Boy Scout Owners and Domains Crossing LLC, and this paragraph that will be inserted into the deeds for lots 47 and 48 will add the reference to that Boy Scout easement.
So that prospective purchasers of lot
correct.
Of these two lots will know that there is the access through the Boy Scouts.
That's right.
Okay. Okay. That's fine. Okay, next item is number 7 in terms of lot configurations.
Okay, this is lot 71, and this is the lot right on the corner of Chesterwood Trail and Dominicus Crossing that was altered as a result of the new detention basin that we talked about last time. In the planning memo, it's pointed out that there is a small triangular piece of property on the back side of the property, which is cut off. The recommendation is to review the shape and determine whether or not that shape is, that little triangle is really necessary. We would prefer to leave the shape of the lot essentially as it is. It's not a buildable part of the site. However, it is an integral part of the land. It helps to square the property off. It's a fairly small lot right now. It's a third of an acre. Yes, you would have to cross the wetland to get to it, but it's part of the just the expansiveness of the property. If we were to drop it off and add it to the common open space, it would mean having to go back and change all the drawings, all the calculations. I'm really not sure it really changes an awful lot in terms of what the town gets or the benefits of the landowner. It's our preference to leave it just as it is.
Do you want to address lot 79 at the same time?
Are you referring to lot
79?
Yes.
Yep. Lot
79 has a similar issue.
Lot 79 is up here. The case of lot 79, which is in the fourth phase, is that there is a long, skinny area that which we noted as a buildable parcel, which is rather difficult to get to. It would be very easy to drop that off. I can't imagine anybody building back there. The logical place to build is where the land is a lot wider. Again, I think the lot itself is fine just the way it is. Lot 79 is one of the larger ones. It's 2.7 acres in size. And the place that it's most likely to have a house built is near the road that's proposed in that area. So again, I don't see the advantage at this point to changing the configuration of the line.
Board members have any comments?
And there isn't the point that that item 7 makes here is that there are two irregularly shaped building envelopes. I can't imagine that the typical house purchaser would want to build back there, but you know, people who are very creative might want to, you know, build a house that was 25 feet square and, you know, 40 feet high, 35 feet high. So I think it leaves some variety available.
Okay, hearing no further comment on that, is there any interest in describing explicitly what the activities are that are allowed outside the building envelope?
Okay. Go to the protective covenants, number 17. We talked about clear cutting is prohibited on the lots. The extent that is consistent with the residential use of the lot, existing vegetation, including significant trees, shall be preserved, particularly along boundary lines with other lots or nearby open spaces. The point that Maureen is making here is that typically activities allowed outside the building envelopes have been restricted to construction of a driveway, installation of utilities, removal of diseased and dying vegetation. That certainly is implicit in the development of the property. And we could certainly add that as an amendment to the covenants.
I think it would be a fine addition if you're willing. That would be very nice.
It's a lot easier to get your driveway. Yeah.
Number 8 is trees.
Number 8 is trees. If you recall, the last time we said that a project of this scale, done at the scale that it's done at, we can't pinpoint exactly where every street tree is going to be. And we said that we would try and locate the trees within 5 feet of the location shown on the plan. Well, it was pointed out if you have your 4-foot sidewalk and a tree is right here, 5 feet away, you can put it on the other side of the sidewalk. That's certainly not our intent. The intent is to follow the ordinance and keep the trees within the esplanade, and certainly keep them within the right-of-way. And so we would certainly add as a condition of approval a note that says that they may be moved 5 feet, but you know, laterally rather than back and forth, to keep them within the esplanade.
Okay.
Is it appropriate to
Please.
Comment on that? I guess the project that comes to mind, I believe the name of it is Cumberland Green, the little semicircle with the big green in the middle. And let me just preface it. I have been harping on the idea of the public aspect of this project since the first day, so this isn't something that's come the last minute. Besides the size of the trees, and again, trees are just another part of there are plenty of trees in there. I'm not concerned about the trees. I'm more concerned about the cluster provision and people not being discouraged when they drive into the development. I mean, town residents and seeing nothing but a lot of large houses packed in without really seeing the benefit that accrues or is supposed to be part of the cluster provision, namely public improvements that make up for the increase in density. And as we've said all along, those may include stone walls, those may include fences that unify all of the different architectural styles or allow for all of the personal ingenuity and creativity that each individual homeowner certainly has a right to enjoy. My concern is that if the homeowner is left to select a tree, that implies that the tree doesn't get planted until the homeowner's purchased a lot.
I think that it should be the developer's responsibility to plant all of the trees, whether or not there are homeowners lined up, that each phase, the trees are carried as part of the public improvements, part of the bonding, and a lot can sit vacant for 10 years, but at least the trees fronting that lot will continue to mature, and they'll be part of the overall development character of each particular neighborhood. And the homeowner then can select any type of tree that the homeowner wishes to within the homeowner's property. What we're talking about here is the esplanade, that portion that's within the public right-of-way, not part of the private property of the homeowner.
Any response, Mr. DeWine?
Maybe there's a compromised position that we'll be putting the first coat of pavement on, and then the second phase, we'll put in the base coat on. Once the base coat is on this one, we'll be coming back and putting the final coat on. If any of the houses are not completed or under construction by that time, I guess at that point, we would then use the trees that are on the planting plan to fill in the gaps where, you know, a home is not under construction and a homeowner has not had an opportunity to assist in selection.
Why does this become the issue of the homeowner and not of the developer? My concern, if it's the issue of the homeowner will only select the smallest tree in most cases. And there's nothing that protects the public interest in cluster development. The one thing that succeeded in Cumberland is that that project stood idle for, I don't know how long, a year and a half, perhaps longer, perhaps Mr. Parkhurst knows. But from the very beginning, there were light poles in there and there were trees growing, and the trees now have matured over the last couple of years, have gotten larger, and as the houses fill in, one always has that that public right-of-way that is improved, and whether the teeth are missing behind it or not is of less consequence. And the trees generally are small enough in street tree planting that the larger trucks are not an issue. The construction interference should not be an issue, particularly since it's on the esplanade side of the sidewalk. If these trees were placed in front lawns and close to proposed home sites, I would be perhaps more concerned, but I think I just think it'd really make for I don't think, I know that the it's absolutely critical that the trees be planted from the very beginning. I think there's going to be enough construction interference from construction of the road, let alone the clearing of the house lots, given the size of the houses and so forth, that there'll be enough to fill in without having to worry about the additional clearing for each house lot.
I'm Peter Anastas, Anastas Lawrence, the builder. I agree with you, Tom. I think that's the way we should do it.
Okay, so, thank you.
But essentially, I think it would actually be better for marketing, to tell you the truth, to have all the trees.
Okay, thank you.
Further question about trees?
Yes, Mr. Parkhurst.
In the memo from your office, Terry, there's a note under tree plantings that says no substitutions would be allowed for red oaks. Where are the red oaks? I looked and I didn't see really where they were specified to be planted.
They're shown on sheets 32 through 38 as street trees along the major road at the intersections and other key places.
So that all the street trees are going to be red oak?
No. There's a variety of trees which have been selected for specific reasons. But the red oak is a predominant tree. It's the tree that's out there native right now. We felt that was a good tree to reinforce the sense of canopy and continuity throughout the project. What we were doing, this is what we presented at the public hearing, is offered people the opportunity to substitute trees that were on the list, but with the exception of the red oaks.
So, Mr. DeWine, why not summarize for us quickly what the situation is with respect to the trees? I know you've gone through it before once, but there seems to be some confusion, so perhaps you could summarize
it. Okay. We have, if you recall, the first time we came before the board, we had a lot of different species of trees of different sizes.
Right.
And this was done after meeting with the town tree warden. We then came back after hearing some comments and simplify the list. We now have a handful of trees that are used throughout the length of the road. We don't feel that monoculture is the proper treatment here for any number of reasons, that we wanted to have some variety, but Red oaks seem to be the tree of choice for the reasons which I stated already. In between the places where there are red oaks, we have selected a number of other trees, yellow birch, for example, tupelo tree, oaks, and so forth. So there is a planting plan which shows trees at the proper spacing in front of every lot, in front of every open space. There are other places where we hope to be able to save trees within the right-of-way, and that will certainly be the desirable location because you'll end up with a lot larger tree right from the get-go.
Mr. Parkhurst?
I do have to apologize. Looking at the plan, I still, even it being pointed out to me, I can't read it because the plan is so small. But Maureen, there's a larger one. It's just my eyes. I apparently are very good.
Mr. DeWan, are a certain percentage of the trees along Dominicus Crossing going to be red oak, or is there...
Well, for example, in phase one, it looks like we have, I don't know the exact number, probably 150 trees. We have 56 trees that are red oak. And I don't know if you can see that. That's the trees that are labeled as QR, Parker Rubra. So as you come in, for example, off of Wells Road, you have four red oaks in a row on the right and two red oaks on the left.
Terry? Yeah, what I've got here is in phase one, if your quantities are right, of all the trees that are planted, the number one quantity is red oak at 55 red oaks. The second one is Canadian hemlock at 48, and I think that's for buffering purposes.
Right, that's correct.
I think the whole intent, the concern that I had raised is that the developer had proposed a vast variety of trees, and there was a desire to make sure that there was going to be a canopy created over the road. And some of the varieties were less of a canopy tree species than some others. So the idea is if you're not allowed to replace the red oak, they're like the skeleton of the canopy tree system. The other trees, some of them are a little smaller, some of them a little more decorative, so they may change a little, but you'll always have that initial skeleton, unless, is that correct, Terry?
That's correct.
And that's the reason why the red oaks have to be replaced by red oaks.
That's why they were not going to be allowed to be replaced. Okay, I think what we're at, the position we're at right now is that the plan that you're seeing, pages 32 through 38, is the plan that will be planted from. There may be, you know, some modifications made, but, you know, this is the people who are going to be moving in here will not have the ability to make alterations within the right of way.
Parkhurst, anything further?
I'm just going to voice a personal thing here. I have a bunch of red oaks in my house, and I absolutely hate them. They are, I mean, the acorns, the leaves don't decompose like maple leaves do. And the trees are very slow growing. I've lived in my house now for 11 years. I've got one at the end of my driveway that's probably grown a foot in 11 years. So it's not a rapidly growing species. So it's not going to create a canopy in our lifetime. And the little acorns, I mean, they go everywhere. Every spring you mow down 1,000 little oak trees.
Well, if people don't like red oaks that much, this is probably not the place for them to build a house.
Anything else on trees? Mr. Emery?
To pick up on Mr. Parker's comment, however, having had some experience with red oaks, certainly larger than 2-inch caliper, 3.5 to 4-inch caliper, they are very slow growing, and they tend to be also of a they're fairly difficult to get in a consistent good quality. The squirrels love them. They're in my neighborhood. They're all over the place. I don't have any prejudice against red oaks whatsoever, but I think it's very important with the number of red oaks that the applicant selects a larger caliper. And if there needs to be a test, then I would suggest that the applicant provide a 2-inch caliper tree in front of
a house with a photograph, just drop it on the ground, photograph it with the proposed house type in the background, and see how out of scale that type of tree is, that size tree, with respect to the proposed development. And again, that comment is only raised with respect to the cluster zoning provision.
Any response? Are we ready to move on to number 9, lots 72 and 73? Mr. DeJuan, any problem with adding a note to the plan restricting driveway access?
The only problem I have is it's not necessary. Lot 72, lot 73 are bordered on three sides and two sides by common open space. If a person wanted to gain access off of Sawyer Road, they'd have to cross the common open space to get access to that property. Really, the only frontage they have is on the new road that's being created. So I don't think it's really an option for people to gain access from any other point than the new road.
Well, perhaps I've seen too many experiences of people trying to be creative lately, but if it's not an option, then it would be a very easy thing to put the note on the plan, and then there would be no argument that somebody...
Arguably, that if you put that note on, why not restrict this lot over here from coming in over here?
There's something about the immediacy of Sawyer Road there that... I don't know. I
have no problem putting it on, but I don't think it's necessary.
Okay. There's a difference between being necessary and being desirable, and perhaps even though it's not necessary, from a planning perspective, it might be desirable. I agree with you that it's not technically necessary, but again, because people have sometimes managed to see what they'd like to see rather than what is directly before them according to someone else. Yes, Mr. Emery.
May I just play devil's advocate for a minute?
Sure.
I mean, I've been on the board long enough, so we've seen a lot of these unusual situations. To the town planner, would it be possible for, and this is not an unusual situation in many subdivisions, for someone to buy several of the lots, say, combine three lots adjacent to Sawyer Road, and then come back to the board and request a public access waiver?
I'd like to echo the chair's comment that people can be very creative.
That's not completely out of the
realm. I'm not going to say it's out of the realm.
Okay.
By the time this segment of road gets up here, this will all be town land.
Yeah.
It will be transferred over to the town.
And I won't say that we haven't had an application before the board where someone has asked for a public access waiver over town land.
Actually,
I'm sure I did. Don't forget it.
If you want it, we'll gladly put it on.
Hearing no objections. Truly, if you would, I do think it would be an improvement unless someone wants to be heard further on it. In that same vein, I think I mentioned this at the last meeting. Are you finished making your notes? I just didn't want to interrupt your train of thought. With respect to lot 22, have no difficulty with that being subdivided, but that is also fronting on Wells Road, and I'd like to have a note added to that lot that says any driveway access from any divided lot would be onto Alicia Circle as opposed to Wells Road.
There is already a plan.
There is?
Yes.
Ah, okay. I missed that.
We added the notes on page 4. It says driveways for lots, and there's a whole range. Lot 22 shall be located so as to avoid wetlands and site distance problems. We are showing the location, the driveway for that lot. And
the current lot for lot 22.
That's right.
Right, but I'm talking about lot 22 can be subdivided, and any resulting lot would also have a driveway that goes on to Alicia Road.
Then it would have to come back to the planning board, is my understanding.
If it were subdivided?
Yes.
But I guess what I'm saying is even now, before it's, if it's subdivided or not subdivided, it would be I would suggest putting a note on the plan now saying any further subdivision would result in driveways only on Alicia Circle, because we've really had a chance to look at that Wells Road issue in terms of traffic quite significantly. Anything further from Mr. Dewan? Anything, any further comments from the board members? Do I hear a motion?
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought you were talking about, still talking about trees.
Oh, no, no, no.
Can I ask? Yes, I have a question.
Mm-hmm.
This relates to the letter of credit. The letter of credit is approximately $1,450,000. Is that right? And the comment is made in T.Y. Lynn's letter of April 14th about the 10% contingency would cover the estimated $40,000 that they think you're light. I just want to understand. The $1,455,000 then includes approximately $150,000 of contingency.
That's right.
Thank you.
For those great unknowns out there.
Mr. Dewan, following up on the issue about the letter of credit, the letter of credit is drafted now as for phase one. And we've got the agreement of incorporating into the letter of credit the comments made by the town attorney, which I thought were all quite good. And just for the benefit of the board members, then, that performance guarantee is posted. Nothing can happen on the site until the town manager and the town attorney agree on that. Phase one is then completed, or at whatever point the applicant wants to proceed with phase two, there then is another letter of credit posted for phase two, in an amount which would be proposed by the town engineer, but in the same format as the letter of credit which is existing?
We've suggested in the back page of our letter what those estimated costs would be for the each four subsequent phases. So that would be a starting point. I assume then that those costs would have to be reviewed by T.Y. Lynn or whoever the town's engineering consultant would be at that point, and an arrangement made to agree upon the amount.
Okay, so what I'm trying to do is work on some language, but I think it would be an amount. I mean, this is obviously a base amount in 1997 dollars. If we're talking about phase four in the year whatever,
yes,
we obviously want to be able to make sure that the performance guarantee is posted in an amount which makes sense at the mm-hmm. time that the construction commences. Mm-hmm.
The nope. language that's on the therefore be it ordered certainly is agreeable to us. And it talks about the amount recommended by the town engineer shall be submitted and approved by the town manager and the town attorney for that phase of construction.
And I think what I'd like to add is the same procedure shall be used for each subsequent phase.
Well, it sounds like that's implicit in that statement. It says no phase of construction shall occur.
Well, okay, then what I would suggest is in the second sentence, the no phase of construction, et cetera, shall occur until a performance guarantee in an amount recommended by the town engineer has been submitted, et cetera. So that's the, I'm sorry, approved by the town engineer. I think we've done what we need. Mr. Emery.
Madam Chair, while we're on the subject of the letter of credit, I note that there's no amount, or at least on the very last page of the packet, next to the last page, appears as though there's nothing in there carried under landscaping. Is that, I know on the last page, there is a landscape cost.
Good point.
There is an amount shown in Phase 1 for landscaping, Tom.
When you say Page 1, are you talking about quantity and unit cost?
Yeah. The summary that we provide on Page 9 has a big item for construction, and then a percentage of that for construction observation, another percentage for contingency. Construction number, for example, in Phase 2, which is 272,000, does include a figure for landscaping, which is based upon the estimates from the construction drawings.
And the landscaping is all of the landscaping shown?
That's included in all these numbers, yes. The breakdown that we provided for Phases 2 through 5 are not as detailed as what we provided for Phase 1.
It would be assumed, though, that when that is submitted, when those phases submitted for performance guarantee, they would be expanded, and that would then be reviewed by the town engineer.
Yeah, and we'll show, just like we showed on T.Y. Lynn's letter, breakdowns by unit cost and so forth. Mm-hmm.
Well, I noticed in my earlier review of the draft of the LC that that landscaping wasn't mentioned, and we certainly do want to make sure that that's included. Any other comments from the board on any aspect? Mr. Parkhurst, oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah, I'm awash in paper here, so please, please pardon me. I'm trying to find this Page 9.
Oh, that's in our March 28th letter, Tom.
So I go from there to the very last page in the packet. There's the landscape. Okay. Then I'll go to the last page under landscaping and just note that the cost per tree is carried at $200. I believe that a larger sum should be carried, at least for a portion of those trees, to reflect a larger size for some of the trees. And Terry, I had one other question on this landscape estimate. Does this include the proposed plantings for the abutters' property?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And on the previous page, there's a seed and mulch that says 75 UN under quantity. What does UN indicate? I'm sorry? Yeah, it's
1,000 square feet.
Okay. Okay, thank you.
Any other comments from board members? Mr. Parkhurst?
Excuse me. Three last little items. I think the last meeting you were, when I'd asked about conveying all the open space to the town, you were concerned about building trails and that sort of thing on town-owned land. I assume that issue has been resolved. One thing that I missed all the way through, I didn't realize the town was going to be building a picnic area, you know?
Maybe building the picnic area.
Why would the town be doing that? I don't understand.
This is the area right here we're offering to the town as part of the open space. If the town wanted to build it, it's a facility that would be suitable for town-wide functions. What we're really looking for is just putting three or four picnic tables out there. I don't think it requires any great capital outlay.
Okay, and the last thing in the, I guess it boils down to a phasing question, pricing. Looking at the phase one housing prototypes, thank you for putting square footages and measurements and all that sort of thing which we had requested. But I'm looking at two houses here. If my memory serves me correctly, phase one was slated to be in the $200,000 price, between $200,000 and $300,000, I guess. I think it'll be a fairly good trick to be able to build a 3,500 square foot house for less than $300,000 in today's market. And I see two of them side by side here with a 3,000 square foot house next to that. Then granted, on either end of that there's a 2,400 square foot house and a 2,000 square foot house. Could you just sort of clarify? I'm not sure if this is a question for Peter.
I think that we wanted to be very conservative. We estimated for valuation purposes how much the houses would be built for out there. And we purposely estimated on the low side. I think the other concern was, is it possible to build, you know, small houses, medium-sized, large houses out in phase one? Or do they all have to be a certain size? You know, is it going to look out of place to have a fairly large house on these lots? And so what we did is took the houses that you saw before, and I have it here if you want to see it again, that was in that elevation, and, you know, went to the town records, got the footprint for those houses, and sketched them onto the plan which is before you right now, just to show you visually what it would look like to have that size house.
I would just a clarification, because I had understood that the development was divided into different neighborhoods, basically at different price points. No, if that's not the case, that's fine. That was just my understanding, that's all.
Any further comments from board members? Mr. DeWan, I wonder if following up on Mr. Parkhurst's comments now would be a good time to hear from Mr. McGovern about what happened at the town council meeting last night.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Amy Bell and other representatives of the developer appeared before the town council last evening looking for conditional municipal approval on this project. The council approved the plans as submitted to the council, all the easements, the language you have, after having had them first reviewed by the Cape Elizabeth Conservation Commission. The vote of the council last evening was 4-3. The reason for the votes of the three councilors who opposed was concern that in the proposal there is no provision for allowing snowmobiles onto the green conservation area, with the exception of for maintenance activities and for grooming of cross-country ski trails. I think I can't say that all three councilors voted negatively that way, but of those who spoke and verbalized their opinions, it was because of concern that snowmobile access was not being allowed except for those limited purposes.
What was the conditional part of the conditional municipal approval?
It's just mirroring the language. It's conditional upon your final vote and conditional upon all of the improvements being built according to the specifications.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, I note the hour is 8:25, and we still have a few other items on the agenda, but I'm not trying to rush anybody. Any further comments by the board or questions? Do I hear a motion? Do I hear further discussion? Mr. Emery.
Madam Chair, may I offer the following motion? I can get started, we'll have one. Motion for the board to consider finding a fact. One, Dominica's Crossing Limited Liability Company, am I starting off correctly?
You're doing fine.
Okay, all right. Let me get my breath here for a minute. Dominica's Crossing Limited Liability Company is requesting final subdivision approval and a wetland alteration permit for Dominica's Crossing, a 97-lot plus one multifamily dwelling unit located off Wells and Sawyer Roads. Two, the subdivision is divided into five phases, and construction must be sequenced to provide for interim public safety needs and appropriate distribution of construction traffic. Three, the subdivision standards require vehicular access to all lots. Four, performance guarantees are needed to assure construction of the project is approved. Five, the town desires flexibility in the timing of construction of a picnic area within the development. Six, the Portland Water District acceptance of the design of the pump station and related sanitary waste facilities is advisable when the district is expected to accept responsibility for the maintenance of the facilities. Seven, the option to add one accessory dwelling unit is recommended in the comprehensive plan and should not be precluded in the subdivision. Eight, regulation of activities outside the building envelope will ensure compliance with the subdivision requirements for buffering. Nine, the boundary and building envelope of individual lots should be configured to minimize disturbance of natural topographic and open space, topography and open space. 10, the planting of trees within an esplanade promotes an attractive road layout. 11, driveway access from Dominica's Crossing Road instead of Sawyer Road is preferred to enhance safe vehicular traffic and traffic patterns. 12, review of all exhibits attached to the conservation easement are needed to confirm compliance with the subdivision open space requirements. 13, the proposed subdivision substantially complies with Section 16-3-1 subdivision standards in Section 19-3-9 wetland regulations. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of Dominica's Crossing Limited Liability Company for Dominica's Crossing, a 97-lot plus one multifamily unit subdivision located on Wells Road and Sawyer Road for final subdivision approval, Section 16-3-1, and a wetland alteration permit, Section 19-3-9, be approved subject to the following condition. So, one, the construction traffic generated in the construction of Phase 3 of Dominica's Crossing be limited to access from Sawyer Road. Two, the performance guarantee be revised in accordance with the comments of the town attorney and in an amount recommended by the town engineer. No phase of construction, nor sale of lots, nor issuance of a building permit shall occur until a performance guarantee has been submitted and approved by the town manager and town attorney for that phase of construction. Three, that the language to be inserted in the deeds for lot 47 and 48 be revised to include rights of access for the Boy Scouts to their adjacent land. Four, that the note on sheet 42 be revised to read picnic area to be built at the option of the town. Five, that a letter from the Portland Water District be submitted approving the pump station and related facilities design. Six, that item two of the subdivision covenants not exclude the potential addition of an accessory dwelling unit. Seven, that activities outside the building envelope be defined to include installations of utilities, construction of a driveway, and removal of dead and diseased vegetation. Eight, that the rear lot line of lot 71 be relocated to immediately south of the detention area. Nine, that a note be added that the trees to be planted in the esplanade shall not be relocated outside the esplanade. 10, that driveway access for lots 72 and 73 be restricted to Dominica's Crossing Road.
11, that the conservation easement with Exhibit C be submitted to the town attorney, town planner, and conservation commission for review and approval. 12, that the plans and application material be revised to reflect the above conditions prior to recording of the subdivision plat. 13, that a suggested minimum tree size be increased from 2 inches to 2.5 to 3-inch caliper due to cluster subdivision development. And 14, that the performance guarantee amounts be amended to reflect the larger tree sizes.
Second that motion, anyone? Mr. Carlson seconds. Mr. Emery, if I could go back for a moment to findings of fact, I wonder if you would accept some clarification. In the findings of fact number 5, the town desires flexibility in the timing of the possible construction, because I don't want to, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Would you accept that?
Yes.
And, and I'd like to renumber number 13 on the findings of fact as number 14, and insert a new number 13 that says, the town has granted conditional municipal approval for acceptance of the open space, just so we record that in the findings of fact. If that's acceptable. And then, with respect to number 2 of the order, that the performance guarantee be revised, et cetera, the second sentence of that would be, no phase of construction nor sale of lots nor issuance of a building permit shall occur until a performance guarantee, and then I'd like to insert, in an amount approved by the town engineer, and then finish the rest of that. And then, I wasn't listening close enough to hear whether or not you had read the number 8, which is on our sheet with respect to the rear lot line of Lot 71.
I believe I did, yes.
I thought that you had, and you meant to do it.
Yes, I did.
Then I withdraw whatever further comments I was going to say on that one. Then I'd like to, let's see, you've got number 13 and number 14. Number 15, I'd like to suggest, is that a note be added to the plan that if Lot 22 is divided, driveway access from any resulting lot shall be restricted to Alicia Circle. Number 16 would be that the language in item 8 of the covenants permitting alteration of water flows be deleted. And I had marked earlier, Mr. Emery, 2 issues which you raised. Did you want to add those as conditions in terms of the contractor being identified as Anastas and Loans?
If it's necessary in order to be sure that that's executed, yes.
Would you like to phrase it in a particular way? I only have written down the issue and not particular language.
Well, generally, the contractor is identified as the contractor, and contractor is capitalized, but in this case, it's not clear who the contract is with, so I think it should be clarified in the document that the contractor refers to Anastas and Loans.
That, so how about this language then, that all references to the contractor in the applicant's documents be deemed to mean Anastas and Loans, Inc., and that, is it ampersand in your, the name of your firm, Mr. Anastas? It's Anastas Ampersand Loans?
I don't know.
That symbol?
This is her.
Okay. You have to ask your lawyer about things like that, right?
Madam Chair?
Mr. Emery, yes.
As an attorney, you clearly understand the implications of the word all. I'm not sure that in every case that the all contractors are going to refer to Anastas and Loans in all of the documents. I can understand it in the covenants in a specific location, but I'm not sure that's the intent in all of the documents.
You just wanted to refer to the covenants?
I would, in the section of the covenant that I referenced, I would just like a clarification that that's referring to Anastas and Loans as the contractor. Design guidelines?
Yeah. So it's just all references in Exhibit A of the covenants?
That's correct.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So we'll revise number 17 to say that all references to the contractor in Exhibit A with respect to covenants be deemed to refer to Anastas and Loans, Inc. And last, I just wrote down the fence issue. Do you want to mention that at all?
I think it would be appropriate to add to the design guidelines that chain link fences are not to be allowed in the front yard areas.
Mm-hmm.
Again, because of the cluster development provision.
Mm-hmm.
And that's Exhibit A.
Then perhaps we could alter number 17 to say that in Exhibit A of the of the covenants, that contractor would be deemed to mean Anastas and Loans, Inc., and the chain link fences, that it would be revised to prohibit chain link fences in front yards.
Does the developer have any concern with chain link fences being controlled in front yard? Okay.
We didn't think so. Okay. Do you have any comments, Mr. Dewan, on any of the proposed restrictions or conditions?
We would like to add a finding of fact. You read it. If you just handed this to me. The developer is contributing to the town an additional 80.87 acres of open space above the 20.59 acres required by the open space ordinance.
The town planner would like to be heard.
I would suggest that the board not add that finding for the reason that there are three open space standards in the subdivision ordinance. One of them talks about preservation of open space for recreation, and that particular standard requires the provision of approximately 1/5 of an acre per lot. And you have gone well over that particular standard. However, there are additional standards that talk about preservation of natural areas, and because of the donation, the large amount of the donation by the applicant, we haven't figured out exactly how much of that land is natural areas, so I wouldn't want it to exactly say that you're 80 acres plus in the bank.
I think there's some reference to the applicant.
Mr. Bryant, would you approach the podium and tell us who you are?
Mr. Bryant from Van Meer and Belanger. I can understand your concern about not wanting to reference in a finding of fact an inaccurate number, but some reference to the notion that the acreage contributed is in excess of the required amount, even if you don't specify by a specific acreage.
And the reason for requesting that is?
Taxes.
An appropriate day to ask the question.
Isn't that tomorrow?
Perhaps the board would like to consider a finding of fact that the applicant has donated land in excess of that open space required under section 16-3-1Q of the subdivision ordinance.
That would certainly be.
That's good.
Would that be acceptable? That's. So that would be number 18.
No, that's a finding of fact.
Oh, I'm sorry, you're right.
Or 13.
Well, actually, let's make that number 14, and then we'll have the substantial compliance should be the last finding of fact. So that would be number 14. Okay, Mr. Emery.
Perhaps we need another, a number 16. Do we need to reference preliminary subdivision approval and state review?
On findings of fact, you're back here?
Mm-hmm.
Town planner?
The way I've proposed the findings is they're directly tied to substantiate any conditions the board has proposed. If you want to make additional findings, certainly you could talk about that you have already granted preliminary approval, that you've held public hearings, that you've gone on site walks, and that you've received evidence of other state and federal approvals.
That's a slippery slope.
Feels like it.
Let's jump ahead then to the conditions. Do I understand that the all state and federal permits are in hand?
Mr.
They are in hand. We're having a minor modification made to our DEP permit.
Which can happen at any time.
You're expected it today.
Okay.
Have one more recommendation for the planning board, that the originally numbered condition number 12 be made the last condition, since it refers to having complete all the above conditions before the plat can be recorded.
So shall we renumber each of the ones that were proposed subsequent to that and make that number 17? Did you get the most recent variation on the numbering of the...
It'll be on the table.
Fair enough. Thank goodness for equipment. Any other comments from planning board members? Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. Just have a brief comment on the letter of credit. In the past, the board has, in the end, been the body that has always actually set the value of the letter of credit. And I hadn't seen Mr. Bradstreet's letter yet on the letter of credit, the performance guarantee setting of the amount. It concerns me that it's proposed that we already begin to eat into the contingency before any of the project begin. And as you look at setting that letter of credit or authorizing the town engineer to set it, I hope it would be understood that the full contingency would be maintained at the beginning of the process in the setting of the letter of credit, as well as the proposed provision with the caliper of the trees.
Thank you very much for clarifying that. That certainly is what I had in mind, because we will be increasing it to some extent, and yes, the 10% contingency should be built in on top of that. Mr. DeWan, do you understand any differently? Okay. Mr. Asselino, you had a comment?
I have a question and a comment. Does that mean that the letter of credit will need to be revised upward? It would need to be revised
upward. The amount, yes.
The amount. And the applicant is agreeing to that.
That's correct.
To cover the revision upward would essentially cover the comments that T.Y. Lynn made, is that what we're saying?
And the extra and the, caliper.
And the tree caliper.
For the trees. I understand. Thank you. On number one of the proposed order, I suggested the vision would be that the reference to construction traffic, is my understanding, is the intention here is that in phase three, is that our intent is to not only limit access from Sawyer Road, but to restrict it from Wells Road. And I would suggest that point number one be revised to read, after Dominicus Crossing Road be restricted from Wells Road and limited to access from Sawyer Road.
How about be prohibited on Wells Road and...
Limited to access from Sawyer, that's fine.
Should it be access and egress?
Yes. Otherwise, you have a bit of a stacking problem.
As a practical matter, who is going to enforce that?
The neighbors.
The neighbors. So the neighbors are all going to start getting guns and shooting tires out of the truck?
What happens is if an errant construction truck goes in the wrong direction, they will call the town and report it, and the town will go up there. And it actually, the large trucks, it's not that difficult to enforce.
There'll be 40 new houses along here.
Any other comments? We have a motion that's been moved and seconded, and I understand that all of the suggested changes are acceptable to Mr. Emery and acceptable to Mr. Carlson.
Correct.
Any further discussion? All in favor of the motion as stated, raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Very
all
best
very
wishes
much.
With the project. You will be getting a letter, Mr. DeWan, of the conditions of the approval, and let us know if you've got any comments, but we really do wish you the best.
Thank you. It's been a wonderful experience.
Now you don't have to go that far. All right, next at 8:45 is the ball field site plan. I guess we'll let the podium get cleared here for a moment before we get the chairs warm with the next bodies. Okay, the next item on the agenda is the ball fields site plans. This is a request by the Town of Cape Elizabeth for site plan review and a wetland alteration permit for ball fields to be constructed at Fort Williams Park on Shore Road and Lions Field on Ocean House Road under Section 19-2-10, site plan review completeness, and Section 19-3-9, the wetland alteration permit completeness. The Planning Board has had the opportunity to at least initially look at these two projects in workshop, and now we are formally before the Board. So, Mr. Bradstreet? Mr. Emery.
I have a conflict of interest this evening on several matters, but the next two I do have to recuse myself.
So, we'll miss your talents.
No, I'll be back, but Dyer Pond.
Okay.
Okay, good evening. I'm Janet McLaughlin. I'm here in my capacity this evening as chairman of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, and we wanted to thank the board for your time this evening and letting us make a presentation to you. The plans that are being presented have come about after a long process of citizen involvement, committee review, town council responsiveness and action, and a workshop with this board last month. The youth at Lions Field is in keeping with the plans of the Lions Club when they donated the land to the town, namely that it be used for recreational purposes. The configuration at Lions Field was developed to recognize the topography in that area. It was also to take into account the cost, which is why we're proposing at this point one field rather than two, and the impact on residential abutters. In response to concerns raised by board members at the March workshop, the parking lot associated with this field has been expanded from 24 to 32 parking spaces. The Fort Williams Field proposal has changed substantially since 1994. The proposed field is a multi-purpose soccer, lacrosse, field hockey playing field that has seen a change in its directional orientation in order to reduce the impact on abutters. In response to citizen concerns raised during the course of developing this proposal, the Town Council has dedicated the entire coastline of the park, as well as the areas immediately abutting both Surf Road and the proposed field, as dedicated open space. In response to public comments at the initial review of the engineer's plans, more trees have been added, have been saved and relocated, and the buffer on the Delano Park side of the field has been revised so that it now includes extended planting areas. You have received in your packets for this evening's meeting documentation that supports the proposed grading and drainage pattern of the field. The proposed field has a crowned slope, and we feel very strongly that the drainage pattern associated with the slope is an important element of the future long-term maintenance of the field and the usability of the field, and the engineers will be much more able to discuss that with you this evening. Steve Harding is the engineer representing the town for you this evening. I'll turn it over to him. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Bob.
Good evening. I also have Mike Belateski, one of my colleagues at House Associates here. The proposal in front of you is actually two ball fields. I'll start with the Fort Williams Field. As we discussed last month, the original proposal for the ball field was oriented in a north-south direction, more closely located to the abutters to the south. Through the review process at that time, the orientation of the field changed to an east-west orientation, and we pushed the field further to the north to provide a greater separation of about 280 feet to the property line to the south. The field itself is about 210 feet by 330 feet. We have a 10-foot relatively flat area around the perimeter to allow a transition for the slope from the playing field to the slope on the sides. There is a gravel parking lot which exists to the north of the field, which we envision will be used for the parking needs of the facility. We're going to be adding an asphalt-covered ramp along a retaining wall to the north of the field to provide access, and this ramp will be constructed to meet ADA laws. The field itself features a crown slope, and that the center of the field will be elevated, and that it will pitch to the edges of the field to the north and the south. This type of grading pattern is better for drainage in that it will get the surface water off the playing field in a quicker manner, which will allow the field to dry quicker, recover quicker, and it makes for a better playing surface. Since the sports that are going to be using the field or be played on the field are often played in inclement weather, that's an important consideration. Another grading concept that we studied early in our design work, and which came up in numerous workshops with the public, was to grade the field from the northwest corner to the southeast corner. This has a number of benefits. it fits the topography of the site much better in that the field slopes this way in its existing state. It also would reduce the construction costs as you'd be limiting the amount of earthwork that you would have to be doing, and you'd also lower the elevation of the fill slope by approximately 4 feet. We feel that the drawbacks associated with that scenario, though, outweigh the benefits. In this scenario, you'd be asking stormwater to travel all the way across the field, which is approximately 380 feet. So you're increasing the maximum drainage length from 110 feet from center to side to something that's over 3.5 times longer than that. This is going to make the lower part of the field wetter than the other portions of the field. And also, you're encouraging drainage to go across the center of the field where a lot of the playing activity is actually going to be taking place. We feel that in the long term, that by not going with the industry standard, which is the crown effect, the ball field will be of lesser quality and require more maintenance to maintain. The Lions Field proposal, I think this exhibit's going to be a little too low for most of you to see, I'm not sure. We wanted to show the entire field and how it was located. It's off Ocean House Road. We have the existing ball field to the left of the access drive, which is paved to the existing ball field. We also have a skating pond, which is located closer to Ocean House Road. The new ball field will be located on the north side of the access drive. There's a second future field, which the council has recommended that the town eventually build. We're showing that location right to the west of the proposed ball field. This secondary field, though, is not part of the current proposal. There's a section of the existing access drive, which is gravel. We're proposing to resurface that, rebuild that, replace the gravel, surface it with a recycled asphalt mix, and construct a ditch along the north side to help the drainage. Currently, this is a very, very soft area in the spring and it causes a lot of problems. This drive will have an extension to it and then a parking lot area. As we discussed at the workshop, there's some concern whether or not 24 spaces would be enough. There really isn't a traffic manual where you can go and get an exact number for that. We did consult with Bill Eaton of Eaton Traffic Engineering. He basically confirmed that while there isn't a traffic manual number to use, he did do some studies, and based on his input, we determined that 32 spaces would be a sufficient number to supply for the field. The field itself is basically a little league dimension field with a 200-foot distance from home plate to center field. It'll be completely enclosed in a chain-link fence. We are showing dugouts to be built alongside the field. We're also showing some bleachers to be installed in the future. We've also shown a future concession stand. This concession stand will require planning board approval before it can be constructed. There's a water line extension that is associated with the project, as well as an overhead electrical line that's been added to the plan. And we're showing a light onto that on a power pole by the new parking lot. This light has a note which says it will be constructed at the town's discretion. And it's put in there at the request of the police department. What they're going to try to do to deter vandalism in the area is increase visits to the parking lot, and they're hoping that that will suffice. If for some reason that doesn't work, they would like to have the ability to put a light up on the power pole to try to, again, deter the vandalism. I can turn it back over to the board for any specific questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hardy. The specific issue before us right now is whether the application is complete. Do any of the board members have any concerns about the completeness of the application? Okay. We need a motion to have it be. Yeah. Okay. Next, we will. I'll entertain a motion for that. But before we get that far, how do people feel about the necessity or the desirability of a sidewalk? any interest in trying to do that? We are required to have a public hearing, at least on the wetland alteration permit, in May. I assume that's when we would schedule it for. But is anybody interested in the site walk? Are you all familiar with the site?
I'm there quite often, so it's not necessary for me.
Mr. Wilcox?
I remember the site, another site walk we had in the same area about a year ago, I would say, so I'm fairly familiar with the area also.
Ms. Carter?
I'm familiar with the site.
Ms. Carlson?
I'm comfortable.
Mr. Aslino?
I've been to both.
Okay. Normally, I'm familiar with, certainly with Fort Williams, less familiar with Lyons Field. I normally strongly recommend a site walk just because we pick up particular things when we're led by someone who wants us to look at particular things. But why don't we say that at this point the board sees no necessity for a site walk, and if you want to talk to us further or if something develops, then perhaps we might revisit the issue at some later date. I assume it's the board's pleasure to schedule. Oh, excuse me, Mr. Carlson.
I just have one question up there at Fort Williams. Are there this field location? Is it posted at all with pink or yellow or
flags
of any kind?
We've got some flag out here. There's a stakes, isn't it, in the corner of the field?
No, I think he's asking, is it going to have a scoreboard or something?
No. Is it right now? Yeah, are there indications of where that field falls?
There are some stakes out there. They're labeled, I believe, corner field.
Yeah, so.
And I think there are some intermediate points.
Okay, fine.
How about with respect to the Lyons Field?
Lyons Field is a little bit different. We have staked those out previously for the study that was done on the alternatives. That location is a little bit further to the west, so it may be a little bit off by
30 feet.
Say 20, but yes, it's actually pushed over a little bit. If you'd like, we could go over and restake that.
It frankly would be helpful to me, and I would suspect it'd be helpful to other board members too. What we'll do is swing okay. by at our own now that we have some daylight after 5 o'clock at night.
We can do that.
So that will be staked fairly soon. Okay. Thank you, Mr. Carlson, for raising that. I assume that it would be the board's pleasure to have a public hearing in May. Okay. Do I hear a motion, Mr. Parkhurst?
Motion for the board to consider, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted and the facts presented, the application of the Town of Cape Elizabeth for a site plan review and a wetland alteration permit for a multi-purpose playing field at Fort Williams Park and a Little League field at Lyons Field be deemed complete. Be it further ordered that the application be tabled to the regular May 20th, 1997 meeting of the Planning Board, at which time a public hearing shall be held.
Do I hear a second to the motion? Mr.
Aslino?
Any further discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. It's unanimous. Excellent. I would suggest, in light of the hour, that we defer any further conversation until next month. So. Thank you very much, and we'll see you then. Section 19-2-10, site plan review completeness, and section 19-3-9, RP3, floodplain permit completeness. Ms. McLaughlin?
Good evening. I'm Janet McLaughlin. I'm here before you in my capacity as chairman of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council. Again, we thank the board for your time this evening. What we are presenting tonight is, as the chairman has stated, is a cliff walk. This, I don't know if you've had an opportunity recently to walk along the existing alignment of trails that are, some of them quite directly on the cliff near the precipice along Fort Williams. If you can start near the Portland headlight and walk back towards the beach area at the cliff. I had an opportunity to take that kind of walk, I think it was a couple of years ago now, on a somewhat icy day, and it was an adventure, to say the least. We are very fortunate. We've had a generous contribution of funding to do construction here, and what we are proposing is a walk that is approximately 1,700 feet long. We're proposing that it be about 4 feet wide. It will be constructed of a stabilized aggregate. In some instances, it will follow the existing alignment. In other instances, it is proposed to vary from that alignment, especially in areas of erosion. We want to make this a safe situation for the users. I'm also very pleased to let you know that the Cape Elizabeth Accessibility Committee has supported the proposal. We have with us this evening Rick Light, who will give you more information.
Let me say thank you.
Thank you, Jim.
Madam Chair, members of the board, if you'll excuse me for a second, I'll try and get our props set up here. A number of visual aids, I think, that to help demonstrate the trail. Is this going to be?
Yeah.
Again, thank you, Janet.
Yeah.
On behalf of the commission and the town of Cape Elizabeth, obviously, we're very pleased to be able to make this presentation tonight. Obviously, I have been working with Mr. Emery in our office on this project particularly, and as you're well aware, Mr. Emery has had to recuse himself, so I'm stepping up to the podium. Briefly, I think there are several things that go on with this application. One is we are here before you because we require site plan review, one of the Fort Williams zone, and secondarily because the proposed trail falls within the RP3 zone for steep slopes, not necessarily floodplain. And just quickly, I think there's two, I'll give a quick summarization of where we're at with the project and then open up to the board for comments. Obviously, this is not a public hearing, but I think the board is probably very familiar with the project. But there are two, I think, views of the project I'd like to present. One is the macro view. What is going on with the trail? Why does it need to be here? And what are the benefits? And then secondarily, as Janet alluded to just quickly, some of the minuscule, more engineering details. What is the trail going to look like? How wide is it going to be? What are the materials? And how are you going to feel the trail as you walk through the park? So I think with that, if everyone can see the plan here, essentially the trail, the existing trail, this is the lighthouse here, and further north towards the Battery Park area. The existing trail is, as everyone I think is quite well aware, is very, very close to the cliff in many places, is terribly eroding, and is needless to say, a hazard in many areas. I think the whole goal of the commission and the people working on the project is simply to make two things, a trail that's more